Most of you are probably relatively familiar with the most common image formats like JPEG, PNG, and GIF. But there's plenty of other uncommon formats you may have seen before but weren't sure what they do. I'll talk about those, as well as some very strange formats that you probably have never seen before. And those, I think, are the most interesting, so we can start with those. But if you do want to see a more detailed comparison about when to use JPEG versus PNG, I have another video I made recently. I'll have it pop out, but also remind you at the end so you can watch it next. The first two are file extensions I've seen before and wondered what the heck they're about, and that is JPEG Large and PNG Large. And turns out that this is basically a made-up file extension that only Twitter used for some reason, where this might not even be the case anymore, but at one point, if you downloaded a image file from Twitter that was deemed as a large resolution, for some reason, it would save as JPG large or PNG large. And it was no difference from a regular JPG or PNG extension. So that's that. Next up, while you may have heard of PNG, have you ever heard of JNG, which stands for JPEG Network Graphics? This format basically uses the PNG file structure, but the actual image data is encoded with the JPEG compression algorithm. But what's interesting is JNG allows the embedding of a second whole image, really, that can be used as a transparency mask, whereas regular JPEG can't. Now, next, you might be surprised to know that there are a whole bunch of variations and extensions of the JPEG format. If you go on jpeg.org, you can see a list of all these variations that have been tried out, although basically none of them have ever taken off. Though here is a comparison table that I made in Excel if you wanna see all the details of all these, but I'm just gonna focus on a few of them. The first is JPEG 2000, which was created in 2000. It has a lot more features than JPEG, and even though you almost never see it, it is probably the most well-supported, I would say. The file extension is usually JP2, and it's pretty much supported by really all image software, but it's not supported by Chrome and Firefox and many other browsers, so because of that, is a major reason it's not ever used. But it does have many features over regular JPEG. For example, it supports transparency, it has a ton of additional possible color channels, a way higher bit depth, it supports something called tiling and region of interest. Tiling basically means you just divide the image into little squares that are all the same size, but you could also literally make the whole image one tile, and each tile is encoded separately. And the reason for that is then you can use a lot less memory when you go to encode or decode the image, because instead of having to decode the whole thing at once, you just do each tile at a time. And a region of interest allows you to embed some metadata about different regions of the image that are notable, and you can label them, and even, for example, have different compression qualities for different parts of the image. So if there's a main subject of the image, you can encode that with higher quality and less compression quality for the rest of it. Another JPEG format I want to mention is JPEG XT. And the reason for this is because it highly focuses on backwards compatibility. So the idea is, even if you use this, it has a bunch of extra features that you can add on that JPEG doesn't support, but any old JPEG viewing software could still view it just without the extra features, whereas a lot of the other formats, if it doesn't support the new JPEG format extension, you can't view it at all. Now, this is not actually really supported by anything that I'm aware of, but I figured I'd still include it because theoretically you could just use it yourself and then you could benefit from all the features if you converted all your images to it. And then if you went and sent the images to someone else, they'd still be able to use the basic 8-bit viewing of it without any problems. It's just that only you'd be able to get the better stuff, but I mean, you still could use it. Now, thirdly, I want to talk about the JPEG XL format, which has the extension JXL. JPEG XL is the latest and most capable edition of JPEG, and it has the features we talked about before, like tiling and region of interest, but it also has stuff like HDR and even animation support. Now, JPEG XL is not very well supported at all, but there is some support for it. One big thing is Chrome does not support it. Strangely, there was a set of versions since like Chrome 90, I think, where they did, and it was behind a flag, so you had to go into the experimental settings to enable it. It wasn't by default, but then for some reason they took it out later. For Firefox, if you use the nightly version, which is basically like a beta version, there's also support in there, but again, behind a flag. So there's not really much default support for it. However, Safari does actually support JPEG XL by default, and also Adobe RAW and Photoshop by extension. If you go into the settings, there's an experimental option where you can enable support for like HDR formats, which includes JPEG XL, and then you can actually save those as that format. And you can also input it too. And there is actually a push to make JPEG XL the replacement of JPEG, partly because it is way more efficient than the old JPEG algorithm. It can compress things a lot more, better than even WebP, for example. However, that's really gonna depend on what software ends up supporting it. Another contender for what might replace JPEG, if JPEG even gets replaced, is AVIF. And that is short for AV1 image file format. And AV1 is actually a video codec. It's a new one that's royalty free that is very good, actually. It's probably gonna replace H.264 because it does a lot better compression with the same file size. And effectively, an AVIF image is just one single frame equivalent of an AV1 video. So it's the same type of compression. However, even though there is a push to make AVIF a standard, I think it's dead in the water for one major reason, which is it's a maximum image resolution. Basically, because it's based on the video codec, which has a max resolution of 8K, it has that same max resolution, which is only like 8193 by 4320. And yeah, while it is somewhat rare to see images higher than that resolution, I don't think it completely will replace JPEG with that, because there are some out there. So again, we'll see if either of those end up replacing JPEG at all. Next, we can go over several formats that you may have seen before, but are somewhat uncommon, but you might wonder what they do. One is bitmap or .bmp. This one actually is more common. I'm sure many of you have heard of it at least. And this is a really, really simple method of encoding. Typically, it's uncompressed and is literally just a 2D array of the pixel and what color goes onto it. So there's not really any special compression like PNG and JPEG does. It's literally just really at a software level, a list of the pixels, what color they are, of course the resolution too, a little bit of basic metadata, and that's it. But it can also use indexed color where it's limited to 8 bits overall, not just 8 bits per channel, and that would be equivalent to 256 colors. So again, if you didn't watch my previous video, basically it would select the 256 most common colors in the image, and instead of labeling each individual pixel with the 3 color channel information, it would just point to which of those colors it is. Next, we have the icon file format, which is .ico, or also the cursor file format, which is .cur. They're the same thing, just different names. And these are typically used for Windows icons and cursors. And what's notable about this format is it is a container for multiple images of the same thing, but different sizes. Like you would expect with an icon, you might be displaying it at a higher resolution or where it needs to be smaller. Sometimes they are very similar looking, but sometimes the icon may actually look very different at a very small version of it, and you can see all those in the icon container. The image types that are actually contained in the file can be either bitmap or PNG, and they can be really any size, from 1x1 pixels all the way up to usually 256x256, and you can really have any number of those in there. Now, technically, you can actually put images in there that are higher than 256. For example, here's a game I found on Steam by just searching my computer for the largest icon files, and this one happens to have a 512 icon in there. But this is pretty rare because Microsoft only recommends you only go up to 256. So usually it's gonna be max 256, but very occasionally you might see higher than that. Next up, we have the DNG file format, which is digital negative. This one's actually very popular among photographers and archivists who need to store the absolute maximum original quality that a camera captures. And that's because DNG is a raw file format and designed to be a universal one. So you may capture an image on a camera that's in raw, and usually each brand is going to have their proprietary raw format. And what's notable about raw formats is they actually store more information compression, even then a uncompressed, lossless format like TIFF. Now, you might be wondering how you can have more information than lossless, so let me explain. Basically, a RAW format saves all the RAW information from the camera sensor as is, without processing it in any way. Camera sensors, like in consumer cameras, basically all use what's called a Bayer filter, where each pixel or sensor site doesn't actually capture the three colors like you have a monitor, where a monitor, each pixel has three subpixels for RGB. A camera has it so each pixel is only going to capture either R, G, or B. And it's usually going to capture more green than the red and blue because our eyes are more sensitive to that. But they all capture the brightness level, but as for color, it's limited for each one. And then what the camera will do is basically decide the other channels of each pixel based on the other surrounding pixels that do use that color. Now, I don't want to get too far into it. There's plenty of videos that explain it. This process is called demosaicing, and it basically just means that based on the raw sensor data, it kind of calculates what colors should be, and that's what it outputs if you save it in a regular image format. Whereas if you save the raw format, it literally just saves the sensor data, and then when you go to display it, it kind of has to do a conversion there. So technically speaking, when you go from raw to even lossless, you are losing some information because the lossless file contains the final calculation of what each pixel should be and not what information was used to make that calculation. So that's the benefit of a raw image file over lossless. Though I do need to point out that if you didn't capture the image using a raw format in the first place, there's no point in using a raw format. It has to be raw from the very beginning, the whole pipeline. If you even use an uncompressed TIFF, you can't convert it to a raw format in any meaningful way because you're not getting that information back. Finally, we could talk about another totally different type of format, which is SVG, or scalable vector graphics. And like the name suggests, this is a so-called vector file format. You see, a regular image that you're probably familiar with pixels, is called a raster image, where the information is saved as discrete pixels. Whereas a vector, you're not saving image information, you're basically saving shape information. So if you were to open an SVG file, you would find that it's literally a text file. And at a basic level, it's basically just defining different points and what type of shape is used between them. And the benefit of this is you can scale it infinitely. Because imagine you have a line that's made of pixels. If you zoom in, then it's made of square pixels, whereas a line is just a line. There's no dimension to it, whereas pixels are 2D. And the same goes for any other shape, like a circle. You can zoom in on the line curve of a circle, and there's no pixels that's making it up. It's literally just the information of where the circle should be, so it's not going to pixelate. You can make it as big as you want. Though if you do export it as another file format that is a raster image format, like JPEG, PNG, then yeah, if you do zoom in after that, it will get pixelated. And that's called rasterizing or rasterization. A lot of times you'll see vector images in graphic design, like another format is EPS, same idea. A lot of times you'll also see logos created in a vector format originally, so you can scale the logo as big as you want without it ever getting pixelated. So really, vector formats are used whenever they can be, though sometimes you simply can't. You can't make a vector image out of a photograph. It just doesn't make sense. But now, in any case, you should have a better understanding of some very weird or just uncommon file extensions. If you found this video interesting, be sure to let me know down in the comments what you think, and of course you can let me know if I pronounced GIF wrong. I'm sure many of you will. If you want to keep watching, the next video is the one I talked about before, in which file format should you be using for images, depending on the circumstance. I'll put that link right there you can click on, so thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.